Hi, thanks for watching this presentation. My name is Simon Strange from Bath Spa University. And I'm looking at art schools in the UK in the 1960s and 70s. And this relationship between the north and south of the UK and how different art schools helped the development of different bands across the regions. So this is part of my PhD research, which has got to be submitted in a couple of weeks. So I was very lucky for some of my interviewees. So Roy Ascott, who lives in Bristol, where I am, and he was influential in developing art school education, more radical forms in the 1960s. He was Brian Eno's teacher at Ipswich. Eno was obviously a very important person to have for my research. Gavin Bryars, a friend of Eno's, who was one of his first recordings in the mid-70s and a key experimental composer. Dexter Darwood, who's a bass player with Bristol punk band The Cortinas from the 70s, and also a Saatchi artist of some repute. Stephen Mander from Cabaret Voltaire, Lester Square from the Monochrome set, Gina Birch from The Raincoats, and Clive Langer, who's a producer with both Madness, Morrissey, it was in a band called Deaf School at Art School. So what really got me interested in this idea about these mix of different elements is just one part of my research, but it's when Dalwood stated, what you don't get now is kids from Manchester, Newcastle, Sheffield coming down to London to study art from working class backgrounds. That whole thing, that amazing period where there were artists from so many diverse backgrounds. And as Leicester Square stated, art school was not just a melting pot of ideas, it was a melting pot of people from everywhere. At art school, you didn't know everyone's background. It's been Frith and Horn famously have famously looked at art schools and bands, but it's worth looking at some of the bands that came through art school. Bands like Scritti Plitti from Leeds, Albertine with the Slits, Raincoats in Hornsey, as well as Adamant, the Monochrome set, Lennon in Liverpool, Townsend at Ealing, Wire in Watford, Humphrey Ocean at Canterbury. So they all came from all over the country, really, and a lot of it just fed into London. London was calling. It was really the autonomy of art school. So by 1970, there were 160 different UK art school, and they were dotted all over the place. So bands also came from these places, and bands such as Bauhaus from Northampton, Throbbing Gristle from Hull, not strictly an art school band, but very much within the art school feel and scenes. Roxy Music through education at Newcastle, then Reading, then coming together at London at the RCA, and also Camberwell and around Chelsea scene. Sheffield, you have Cabaret Voltaire, Cambridge, Pink Floyd, and Liverpool, the Beatles. But these just shows you the disparate elements of music and these bringing these scenes together. And as Malander stated, our antenna was really attuned to these whole scenes. One of the things that brought the people together at this stage and brought the music was bring together art and life, life is art. So this is a real postmodern concept. And Gina Birch really stated that she's still living this. She still feels her life is like art school, really. It's creative, it's art, it's music. Leicester Square stated how he went to art school because it was a lifestyle choice rather than a vocation. It was the kind of thing that one ought to do. Whereas Malander stated the art college of the post-war period was part of a popular culture and he couldn't really escape it in that sense. Eno also brought this idea into the research, the discovery of your place within the world and how this manifested within art, where part of the deal was that you were what you believed in. These concepts were brought through where art school, it sort of changed the idea about what young people, young creators could do. So instead of working in factories or working in offices and shops, or even the aimlessness of life on the Dulwich Walk estates, they could go to art school There was funding. It was possible to be created. There was a mix of people. It was perfect. It was perfect in that sense for people that were that wanted a creative experimentation. But the places I'm concentrating on are the more radical art school. There was lots of art schools which didn't have the same radical edge, but the ones I'm looking at, where the musicians went to or came out of, were the more radical ones. One of the key schemes for my research was by Belgian theorist Thierry de Duve, and he had these three elements about where art and art education sat, and really it's the creativity, medium and invention, which could be related to the Bauhaus, to modernism, and I kind of put into the post-punk area, and also the third one, where attitude, practice, so a focus on the process and deconstructing previous ideas. These are postmodern concepts. These are obviously very punk. So this for me, this really, really connects these things together. There's the transference of information and groups across the UK. So in the mid-50s, you had the Scarborough Summer Schools, where artists such as Bridget Riley went to, and it was run by Harry Thubron, Tom Hubson and Victor Passmore, based at Newcastle and Leeds, and they brought these ideas from the Bauhaus. They brought the basic design to the UK, and really Newcastle and Leeds were these two key schools. Passmore called them the Tower of Babel because they were just the key ones. At Newcastle, instead, you had Passmore, you had Richard Hamilton, a key pop artist. Roy Ascot went there. Rita Donagh, who later married Richard Hamilton, but she was a key. Again, she taught Mackay from Roxy Music at Reading. She brought these ideas from Newcastle down to Reading, which then went into London. Next then were Leeds, very, very different and much more avant-garde, eclectic, much more, I suppose, not dynamic, but more radical ideas really came through. So the Fluxus movement, Robin Page and Jeff Nuttall, TJ Clark brought ideas about situations international in. So bands like Gang of Four, Skritti Plitti, the Mekons, Delta Five, they came through this. They came through these kind of this education system there. And they came down to London, but there's other things going on in London as well. So these conceptual ideas, the research shows that the conceptual ideas really developed at Hornsey. So the 70s was a very musical cohort at Hornsey, and the conceptual ideas filtered down into Hornsey and into musicians there. There's also St Martin's on the sculpture course. At Walthamstow you had Ian Dury, you had Peter Blake, the whole pop art scene. And at Goldsmiths, so you had John Thompson and Michael Craig Martin develop the kind of eradicating barriers between different art forms, and that led into the young British artists of the 1980s and 1990s. So the experimental courses, the ones I concentrated on, and as I say, these are the ones that kind of really linked in with the musicians. So you've got the basic design and avant-garde from Newcastle and Leeds. Feeding into the ground course, so Roy Ascot at the ground course and looking at cybernetics, looking at systems-based processes. You've got Peter Carnier, the A course, a lot room at St Martin's. It was very dramatic, aimed at disorientating students. I think they spent the first term, I think there's 12 students, but the first term every day in a lot room. They were brought materials, they weren't allowed to communicate with each other, and it was just to see how they developed. It was just taking away, it was a blank canvas, they were taking away all their previous learning. And then there's the art theory group, which started at Coventry, then disseminated into other schools, especially Leeds, looking at conceptual ideas, really breaking down the idea of what art was. And then, like I said, Rita Donagh at the White Room, creating a similar idea really to Peter Carnier at St Martin's, but slightly less dramatic. But it was about envisioning space and how you could use space and creativity from with minimal materials and minimal ideas and a blank canvas again to work from. And Eno stated how referring to London, that it was interesting that a lot of these things didn't come through the London colleges. He stated, I think it was thought they were already very successful in one area. People who are very successful in one area tend not to desert it. They were doing fine. So why should they? Looking a bit at the ground course, Roy Ascot's ground course, he stated that he was about 20 when he came down to Ealing, bringing down those basic design ideas to London. He was almost like, there you go, sent off to do it. But then when he developed this ground course, he added some of his own concepts, which then interested scouts from London. So they were coming to Ipswich to look at these ideas. And Eno noticed this, and also how connected he was. There's an eclectic mix of teachers from all different art forms, science and all philosophy and politics. And Eno found this very, very exciting. And the main thing there was, like I say, was cybernetics, which, breaking it down, looking at disorientating students, focus on the process over the product, being risk-taking, not being afraid to kind of try and experiment with ideas, and also collaboration. The fact that art wasn't about the single painter in the attic, it was about people coming together to create. Eno related the idea of a seniors to a mixture of genius with a societal ecosystem. And you can see this coming through art school, and you can see this coming through those music scenes as well. They're kind of, I suppose I call them non-hierarchical scenes, because there's a lot of chance elements and people were coming from all over, and this big melting pot of ideas and people coming together was absolutely crucial and dynamic in the 60s and 70s for these students. Not for all students, but for these students. And Ascot related this to cybernetics, where people interact freely in groups, producing unfamiliar situations, catalysing perhaps further group responses. One of the key exhibitions at the time was Cybernetic Serendipity at the end of the 60s, that mixed art, music, technology, different concepts together. So it's bringing these avant-garde ideas, but into a very, it's quite a commercial, in the end, a commercial exhibition. So Cabaret-Voltaire also talked about these ideas of transference. Manada stated how they were very aware of the Sex Pistols, McLaren, before they really broke, and that's largely down to the fashion. They used to go down to London from Sheffield. They say that Sheffield, actually, people in Sheffield were very into fashion, which kind of linked them into with Roxy Music, and people were coming down to London, to Camden, to King's Road, and that's how they became aware of the Pistols. And he felt there wasn't really a scene at all. There wasn't like an electronic music scene before punk happened. It was really the instigator of this. They were involved with Sheffield Polytechnic. Richard H. Kirk went there for 2 terms, I think it was. Manada didn't. He actually works in art school now, which is quite funny. But they were so involved in that art school scene. They played a lot of gigs there. They went there. They hung out with people there. So they kind of, they got those art school ideas, were sort of instigated from those art school times. And Hornsey, so those conceptual ideas came down to Hornsey and really became part of this. I mean, Leicester Square stated, and also Gina Birch, both went to Hornsey and stated how musical their cohorts were, but also very conceptual. Leicester Square talks about him when he was actually assessed to go into the art college, and how the person before him had a dummy of a policeman with a little button on it, and if you press the button, the policeman would laugh. So it's a laughing policeman. So whenever any of the assessors asked this student a question, he would just press the button. Obviously, he got in because they were looking for a conceptual. They were looking for people that would take any of these ideas in. And he stated how a lot of the ideas were, a lot of the things which were going on were so postmodern and surreal. I think he said about one day when Cliff Richard came to do a talk, whereas this was followed by a screening of Deep Throat on the same day, and it really showed the eclectic mix of things which were going on. But he also stated that it wasn't, you know, art school wasn't really a vocation, it was a lifestyle choice. It was the kind of thing that one ought to do. Langer went from Canterbury to Liverpool, so he went the other way around. But he didn't go to Canterbury because of Kilburn and the High Roads. but because of the Canterbury scene. So bands like Caravan and Soft Machine, a love of Robert Wyatt for him comes from there. And also Manada stated how bands seem to come from art college, with bands like Death School, again Kilburn and the High Roads, Humphrey Ocean, and how it spread in a pre-internet era between art schools, between bands and subcultures. Experimentation was very, very much part of the art school and those music genres as well. Eno stated how being an art student kind of encouraged and you relish the experiment. I'm just going to do and see what happens. Also an individuality of art school that encouraged the experimentation. So students were, you didn't have to have entry qualifications. It was a chance to get away from the dole. And it also gave the teaching of established art techniques against which students were expected to rebel. So it was a kind of rebellious against the order. Even the Coldstream report from 1960, which was a government report into art education, and it brought the diploma, art diploma into art education, but it still left an autonomy with art schools and the chance for them to actually explore and almost rebel against these ideas. Ascot especially was one of those people that rebelled against that. Bryars stated how art colleges encouraged independent thought and using your invention. So someone who later became a rock musician would go through that. There was nothing specific that comes through except for the attitude or frame of mind. Some of the radical movements which came through art school connected art school and punk and post-punk. So the Situations International, where Bernie Rhodes and Malcolm McLaren were very much looking at these ideas, where, you know, the idea about embracing unemployment, the spectacle and fun and being risk-taking. Whereas art and language was a little bit more conceptual. I see it feeding more into the post-punk and new wave scenes. But again, it's quite radical and going against the grain. So there's the mix of experimental and the commercial that Fisher saw. And Langer saw this in the band. He was in Death School, in Roxy, and other bands as well. But there's also, he realised that they didn't really transfer. Death School didn't transfer to the South as Roxy Music had. So Roxy Music had a massive following in the North, and it's very much built around the glam scene, as Manada stated. But they transferred down. They came down to London. Death School didn't. And never really translate to the southern audiences, which is quite an interesting point there. But Eno stated that pop music has never just been about pop music. It's always been about some sort of social statement, stylistic statement, and art students were always interested in that. Also, Dawood noticed that now it's really different, that it's not, you don't get this tribal thing anymore. You don't get people, students saying that I'm this kind of person, or whatever, but there you could be, he said, you could be a goth on a Thursday, you could be a punk on a Friday, and you don't get this tribal concept come together. And Manada again saying it's such a different world now. The main difference now is the volume of things going on. So when we began to see bands like Roxy Music, Can, Talking Heads, Kraftwerk, the Sex Pistols, they were the only bands that were really doing anything different. And it was these art school cohorts, was an inclusivity of class. So with this melange mix of people, there wasn't, you know, it was a space funded by the state. So it really allowed people to come to this education who hadn't before. So Brighton called it a space for the intelligent illiterate, or Frith and Horn, for where artists of outstanding promise, where the loophole, so artists of outstanding artistic promise through the loophole for the loopy, were exempt from barriers to academic entrance. And finally, it was Eno stated how it's really these outsiders. So this situation at art school where there was a multitude of people allowed in, you didn't need to be technically brilliant. It was about your ideas, your concepts, and how malleable, how open you were, I suppose. And he felt that it's the Young Turks outside or who produced the interesting results sometimes. Then he started thinking and calling pop music as outsider art. He's thinking that pop music really allowed a lot to go on within its boundaries. And then everything I like about pop music is tied up with that. The idea of it being made by community without conspicuous leader. The idea that it's part of your living. It's just the way you are. So just in concluding, this interpersonal transference where concepts came between North and South UK from the key art schools of Leeds and Newcastle fed into London, where this is life is art is life, crossover, non-hierarchical concepts where attitude, practice and deconstruction were key, experimental ideas, and there were seniors of mixed cohorts all across the UK. That really brought this melange of very creative people together. So thank you very much. My name is Simon Strange, I said, and my webpage is called Blank Canvas, looking at that idea about unlearning disorientation, and you can find out more about it on my Facebook page or just get in contact with me directly. And here are some of the references I use for this presentation. Great. I hope you have a great conference. Thank you. Bye.